here's a few reasons why people don't go to church.
I can't come to church until I get my life together.
Church is how I got my life together.
Church is filled with a bunch of hypocrites.
And there's always room for one more.
All they care about is your money.
They care about me, not about my money.
Is there some kind of dress code?
Yes, the code is wear some clothes.
Church, it just makes me nervous.
I was nervous at first, and then I felt right at home.
I'm not sure I believe everything that you believe.
But you can still belong.
Church is for wimpy, girly men.
You want to say that again?
If you knew me and what I've done, you wouldn't want me.
If you knew me and what I've done, you wouldn't be worried.
You can come to my church even if you were brought up
Catholic,
Baptist,
Methodist,
Jewish,
Mormon,
Lutheran,
Pentecostal,
Presbyterian,
Church of Christ,
Southern Baptist.
A little bit of everything and a whole lot of nothing.
See, it's not about a religion, it's about a relationship.
So please, come to my church.
Where nobody's perfect.
Where beginners are welcome.
Where socks are optional.
But grace is required.
Where forgiveness is offered.
Where hope is alive.
And where it's okay to not be okay. Really.
Hello, and welcome to our all-age family service. Wherever you're watching, and indeed whenever you're watching, we're delighted that you are with us, so a very warm welcome to you. As we begin our service, we do so with some opening responses. Please do join in with the words in bold type. O Lord, open our lips, and our mouth shall proclaim your praise. Give us the joy of your saving help, and sustain us with your life-giving spirit. We have the chance now to proclaim God's praise together in the words of our opening hymn. The video is from the BBC programme The Songs of Praise, from their Big Sing event from a number of years ago. We'll be joining with thousands of other people at the Royal Albert Hall, singing God's praises and particularly focusing on Jesus, the one who is the Lamb upon the throne. So let's sing together this great hymn, Crown Him with Many Crowns.
Oh,
Well, that wonderful opening hymn reminds us that Jesus is the Lord of all things. He is the true King of Kings. And yet the reality of our lives doesn't really speak that truth. I know, speaking for myself, that I often fail to live with Jesus as King of my life. And if you're anything like me, then it's important to come to God and say sorry for those things. We're going to do that together now in the words of confession. The words will appear on the screen in just a moment. And if you'd like to, and if it's right for you, please join in with the words in bold type. Let us pray together. God our Father, we come to you in sorrow for our sins, for turning away from you and ignoring your will for our lives. Father, forgive us. For behaving just as we wish without thinking of you. Father, forgive us. For failing you by what we do and think and say. Father, forgive us. May Almighty God, who sent his Son into the world to save sinners, bring you his pardon and his peace, now and forever. Amen. Well, I wonder if you've ever played a game of word association. The idea is to say the first thing that you can think of associated with a particular word. So, for example, if I were to say the word car, you might think of wheels or a windscreen, fast or slow, depending on who is driving. Well, we're going to play a quick game of word association together now. As the word pops up on the screen, think about it for just a second and call out the first word that comes into your mind associated with that particular thing. So word number one, pizza. Word number two, holiday. Word number three, football. Word number four, sprouts. And word number five, church. So how did that go? If you played along with others at home, did you share any answers in common? It might be for the word pizza that you called out your favourite topping. Perhaps for the word football, you called out the greatest team in the world, Tottenham Hotspur. Maybe not. What about the word sprouts? Did that make you say yummy or yucky? Well, I'd be very interested to hear what your word was for church. There's a story of the youngster who was being shown round his local church by the vicar. They looked at the architecture and admired the stunning stained glass windows. And eventually they came to a plaque at the back of the church. The vicar turned to the boy and said, "This is a list of all those who died in the services." The boy turned to the vicar and replied, "Which one, the morning or the evening?" Well, hopefully that's not your view of church, that it's so boring it could bore you to death. But for many people, they do associate church with things that are quite dull, maybe thinking it's rather old-fashioned or out of date. Just a dusty old building. Today we're going to think together about the word church. And hopefully we'll answer together two questions. Number one, what is church? And number two, what are the characteristics of church? First of all then, what is church? Well, the very best place to go to find the answer is, of course, the Bible. It'd be a great idea to have your own Bible to hand. So if you need to, why not press pause now, go find your Bible and come back and unpause the video so you're ready to follow our first reading. Well, hopefully we're all good to go. And here is Elizabeth with our first reading from 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 4 to 6.
The first reading is from 1 Peter, chapter 2, verses 4 to 6. As you come to him, the living stone, rejected by humans, but chosen by God and precious to him, you also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For in Scripture it says, "See, I lay a stone in Zion, a chosen and precious cornerstone, and the one who trusts in him will never be put to shame." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
So what is church? In these verses, it is the church that Peter is writing about. And if you take another look with me back at verse 5 of our reading, you'll see that Peter refers to the church as a spiritual house. Spiritual house? Well, what does that mean? Well, to understand what Peter is talking about, we need to go back in time. Back in time to King Solomon, the son of King David, and the moment in history when he built the temple for God. We're going to watch a short video that describes those events to us. Let me encourage you to watch and listen carefully and to see what you can find out about the temple.
Solomon was the son of King David and had grown to become a great king himself. Solomon was a very wise king and he did many great things. But the greatest work of Solomon's reign was the building of the house of God, which was called the temple. Solomon planned very carefully. That's because building the temple was very important work. It mattered a lot to Solomon. That's because his father, King David, had wanted to build the temple and had prepared for it by gathering lots of gold, silver, stone, and cedar. Solomon knew how much the temple mattered to his dad. He knew how much it mattered to God. So building the temple mattered to Solomon very much. He took great care to make sure everything was just right. The temple stood on Mount Moriah, which is the exact place where Abraham took his son Isaac to be sacrificed. The place where Solomon's father David had built an altar and the Lord appeared to him. This was a very important place designed for a very important task, building God's house. Cedar for the roof was brought from faraway lands, and all the stones for the building of the temple were chiseled and shaped and fitted together before they were brought to Mount Moriah. And all the beams for the roof and the pillars of cedar were carved and made to join each other. This was so that as the walls arose, no sounds of hammers or chisels were heard. God's house was built quietly. Because building God's temple so that people could worship was so important to Solomon, he used the finest materials to build it. The walls were covered with pure gold. He decorated it with precious gems. Nothing was too good for God's house. It took King Solomon and his men 7 years to build the temple, but at last it was finished. When it was done, Solomon brought all the things his dad, King David, had gathered for the temple, the gold, silver, and other important items. Then he had the Ark of the Covenant brought to the temple where it would sit in a place of honor, in the house of God. Finally, Solomon held a great service to let the people know the temple was ready. Solomon's greatest work was complete. He cared about the house of God. He cared about worship. So God used Solomon to build his temple where people could worship the one true God.
Well, I do hope you found that video interesting and helpful. In 1 Kings chapter 8, verses 10 to 13, it says this. When the priest withdrew from the holy place, the cloud filled the temple of the Lord. And the priests could not perform their service because of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord filled his temple. Then Solomon said, "The Lord has said that he would dwell in a dark cloud. I have indeed built a magnificent temple for you, a place for you to dwell forever." The temple in the Old Testament was all about God's presence with his people. So as Peter begins to describe the church, and does so referring to it as a spiritual house, he is telling his original readers, and indeed us as well today, about how God dwells amongst his people now. Let's dig into the verses together to find out a little bit more. What is the church made up of? Well, verse 4 says, "As you come to him, the living stone, rejected by men but chosen by God." First of all, we have this living stone. And here, Peter is talking about Jesus. And later on in verse 6, Jesus is referred to as the cornerstone. So Jesus, the living stone, or the cornerstone, is the first component of this spiritual house. And everything else is built upon and around him. So what is the second part of this church building? Have a look at verse 5. I think we find the answer there. Can you see it says, "You also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house." Peter is telling his readers that they also are like living stones. And this is true of all Christians throughout all generations. The church is God's spiritual house, built up around the person of Jesus and made up of believers. Some of you might have heard the phrase, "Church is not the building, it's the people," and thought it rather cliche, but it is true. As these verses from 1 Peter tell us, the church is made up of people, not bricks and mortar. Here in Buckland Monachorum and Milton Coombe, we have two delightful and beautiful church buildings. They've been the venue for Christians to meet together over hundreds of years, and of course we should look after them and be thankful for them. But we mustn't think that these stone buildings are church. What is the church? Well, it's the people of God who meet inside these buildings, or outside, as we're having to do at the moment. Church is God's people together. In other parts of the Bible, the church is likened to a body made up of many parts. It's described as a family, as a vine with many branches. And those images, along with the one that we're introduced to here in 1 Peter chapter 2, remind us that the church is the people of God. Christians, both here in our community, around our nation, and indeed across the world. We are all part of God's great spiritual house. We are all part of God's big family. And that is a wonderful privilege. Well, we're going to sing together now. And these next two songs cry out for actions. So perhaps in the safety of your own home, you might want to come up with your own actions. Perhaps you already know some actions to these songs, so do join in with them as we sing. We're going to have two songs back to back. The first that reminds us we are all part of God's big family. And the second that reminds us we have a great big God who cares for us and holds us in his hands. Let's sing together.
Small. Some of us like pink and some like blue. Some of us like reading books. Some of us like feeding ducks. That's because we're different, me and you. But God loves everyone he's made. You and you and you and you and you and you. God loves you. God. have specs to wear. All of us have different families. Some of us are very loud. Some of us don't make a sound. That's because we're different, you and me. But God loves everyone he's made. God loves each of us in a special way. That's you and 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 you. God loves you. God loves you. That's you and 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 you. We're part of the big family of God. 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 God loves everyone he's made. God loves each of us in a special way. That's you and 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 you. God loves you. God loves you. That's you and 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 you. We're part of the big family of God. 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 We're part of the big family of God.
Our God is a great big God.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I do hope that you're not too worn out from those energetic songs. It's time now for our second Bible reading. So, Bibles at the ready, and let's turn together to Acts chapter 2.
The second reading is from Acts chapter 2, verses 42 to 47. They, the believers, devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
We've answered our first question, what is the church? We found out that it's not a building or an event on a Sunday. The church is God's spiritual house made up of living stones. It is God's people, his family. What about that second question? What are the characteristics of church? Well, as we look back to the book of Acts, we read about the very first church. They didn't have buildings to meet in, so often met in people's homes or in the grounds of the temple. The apostles taught them many things about God, and God did amazing things through the church. So what were the characteristics of the first church? First of all, we learn that it was a learning church. John Calvin, a famous Christian of yesteryear, said, "The church is seen where Christ appears and where his word is heard." In other words, it's possible to have a Christian church without a church building, without ordained ministers. Not that I'm looking to do myself out of a job, church wardens and PCC members, and even without music. But there can be no true church without the gospel of Jesus, without the word of God. Have a look with me back at verse 42 from Acts chapter 2. And there you can see that they, that is the believers, the people of God, devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. I guess you could say that 2,000 or so years ago in Jerusalem, a school was started. The teachers were the apostles. The pupils were the 3,000 or so mentioned in verse 41 who were added to their number. Now, of course, church and school are not the same things, but there are similarities. In both, there are teachers, those who explain things to us, who help us to learn. At school, we learn to read and write. We learn how to add and subtract. We learn how to think about the world around us. There are lessons like geography, history, science. We can learn a foreign language or two and much more. What a privilege it is to have an education. It's in the church, however, that we learn the most important lessons of all. We learn how to live as God's people. We gain wisdom so as to know how to react and behave in certain situations. We learn how to treat others around us and how we can best love them. But above all of those things, most importantly, we learn about Jesus and about how through him we can have a relationship with God, our Creator. As well as teachers, books are another similarity. In schools, we have textbooks to help us learn. In church, we have the Bible. But whereas in school, the teacher might not always use a textbook, in church, we must always use the Bible, as it is God's word to us. The New Testament reminds us repeatedly that Jesus Christ is the head of the church. And it's only as we submit to his authority, found in his word, the Bible, that the church functions as it should and flourishes as he intends. The early church was devoted to the apostles' teaching. And as a church today, we need to be devoted to God's word, the Bible. Not only when we meet on Sundays, but in youth Emmaus, in our children's groups, in our midweek groups and home groups, in our own daily Bible studies. Let's be a learning church. So verse 42, they devoted themselves to the fellowship, that is, to one another. Verse 45, they gave to anyone as he had need. Verse 46, they continued to meet together. This early church from Acts chapter 2 was a loving and a sharing church. How astonishing are those verses, verses 44 and 45, that they were willing to sell their possessions in order to meet the needs of others. Isn't that an incredible example to us all? What a loving church it was. Now, this doesn't mean that they saw their possessions as bad things. It means they were willing to make available anything they had in order to help those in need. Essentially, these early believers weren't selfish or all greedy, simply trying to gain and gather for themselves lots of material goods. Instead, having learnt about Jesus, they sought to live like Jesus, to love as he loved, putting the needs of others before their own needs, recognising that God's kingdom is infinitely more valuable than any material goods or earthly possessions. They helped meet the physical needs of one another, but they also sought to meet each other's spiritual needs. And that's another function of church. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25 tells us not to give up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing, but to keep meeting to encourage one another. I'm sure you have all heard of Lord Nelson, the famous naval admiral. Well, Nelson described one of his many victories in the following way. He said, "I had the happiness to command a band of brothers." Nelson's crew had grown closer together through the rigours of war. They had stuck together through the hardships of rationing, of sleepless nights, of fighting at sea, so much so that they had become like a family to each other, a band of brothers. In a similar way, the church should be a place where we support each other through thick and thin. We should be loving towards one another, concerned about one another, seeking to be encouraged and to encourage those around us. After all, we are part of the same family, God's family. We are quite literally brothers and sisters in Christ. The believers here in Acts chapter 2 put others first, sharing their meals, their time, their possessions, their money, sharing everything. We don't go to church. We are the church. And therefore, we have to follow their example. At this present time, we are perhaps coming to understand that more and more. Although we cannot meet together physically, we can still function as church, learning together, albeit online or through things delivered in the post. Loving one another by caring for each other through phone calls and offering to run errands. Sharing with each other by offering to make meals or pick up that extra bit of shopping. Praying for each other and sharing one another's burdens. One important question for us all is, how can we continue to do this after the present crisis? Let's be a loving church. These verses from Acts chapter 2 tell us that the early church worshipped in the temple courts, but also in their homes. It tells us that their worship involved the breaking of bread, which probably refers to the Lord's Supper, the sharing of bread and wine to remember Christ's sacrifice on the cross. But it might also refer to them simply sharing meals in one another's homes. We're told that they prayed together, and that every time they met, it was with glad hearts, praising God. But hang on a moment, Andy. Some of you might be saying, isn't worship more than just meeting together and doing these things together? If that's what you're thinking, you are absolutely right. Worship is more than just meeting together on a Sunday. Worship isn't simply the music we play or the songs that we sing. Worship doesn't begin during the opening hymn of a service and end with the closing prayer. Worship is a whole lifestyle. Worship involves the way that we live, the way that we speak, the way that we behave. But church has an important part to play. Howard Marshall writes this: in a real sense, the church is a service station where Christians are serviced so that they in turn may serve God better. We do not meet together so much as to worship God, than to encourage one another that we might be equipped to worship God more effectively in the whole of our lives. So the time before and after church is vitally important. It's when we speak to one another to get to know each other better, so we might pray more informed prayers, so we might know how we can love and share and care more effectively for one another. The early church was a learning church, a loving church, and a worshipping church. In some ways, the lessons we learn here are remarkably straightforward. The early church simply remained faithful to God, faithful to his word, and faithful to one another. Perhaps we as the modern church today need to carefully and prayerfully think about this. Are these the characteristics that we champion and we cherish? This week, why not take some time to think on your own or to chat with others about your understanding of this word church? What does it really mean for you to be part of God's spiritual house, to be part of the big family of God? I want to ask yourself some questions, and these questions are for young and for old and everyone in between. Do you long to learn to love God better? Do you want to learn more about Jesus and how to live like him? Do you want to love others in the church family more effectively? Is there an area you can serve? Where are the needs in the church family? And what could you do to encourage another believer to worship God with their whole lives? How can you find out more about what needs they have? How you can pray for them and encourage them forward? My prayer, and I hope our prayer, is that we would be a learning church, a loving church, and a worshipping church. Amen. We're going to spend some time in prayer now, and the Peskett family are going to lead us. So let's pray together.
Dear God,
as we come together to pray in these uncertain times, we fix our eyes upon you and remind ourselves who you are. We praise you, the Almighty God, who has brought all things into being, set the planets in motion, as well as caring for the smallest things in creation. We acknowledge that you're an awesome God, steadfast, unchanging, and faithful. We thank you for the work of your Son on the cross to bring us into a relationship with you, and that you consider us worthy to be your hands and feet, the body of Christ, the church in this world. Today we pray for your church. Dear Lord, we pray for the worldwide church. We give thanks that your message of hope knows no borders. We pray that this message of hope will spread and bring comfort for those in fear or distress at this time. We pray for boldness, compassion, and strength in all Christians. We pray that our common humanity, exposed by the COVID crisis, will inspire the body of Christ to work more effectively together. May a time of trial and refinement lead to growth. May we play our part in the body. May your kingdom come.
Our Father, we thank you that you are God over the UK Church. We thank you that your beloved family are able to meet together virtually throughout this land, despite churches being closed. We ask that you minister, encourage and comfort your church during this challenging time. Help us as your body to reach out in this country and bring your hope, truth and comfort to people up and down the UK. Let your church be your hands, feet and words despite the challenge. May they lead people to be interested in getting to know you and finding out more about you. Amen.
Amen. Dear God, we pray for our church here in Buckland that we would all be safe during coronavirus. We ask that you keep Reverend Andy encouraged as he leads us during this difficult time. We ask that you would be particularly close to people who live alone, who are lonely or sick. Inspire us as a church family to look after our neighbours and friends as Jesus tells us to. Thank you, God, that we have each other and you are keeping us safe and you love us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Right, we're going to do the Lord's Prayer, okay? Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you very much, Peskett family, for leading us in prayer. As we come towards the end of our time together, may I just flag up two things very briefly. First, to say that on our website, on the resources page, you'll find some useful downloadable items put together by our youth worker Tristan and his wife Sarah, aimed at children and young people to encourage them to think some more about our theme of church. Second, could I flag up a really useful book called How to Walk into Church by Tony Payne. It's a short little book, but it's packed full of really helpful and encouraging words. So do buy it, read it, share it, and discuss it in the coming weeks. We're going to sing our final song together now. It's called O Church, Arise. It's a wonderfully encouraging song, but it might be new to some of you. Please enjoy the words and the music. And the joy of having this recorded is that you can go back afterwards, re-watch it, and join with the singing a second time round. So let's sing together, O Church, Arise.
And
Thank you very much for joining us as we close a prayer of blessing. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. So as God's people, let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.